Finally say something. Okay, welcome back to Nick Lenz's Comic Corner, Classics as Non-Classics. This is episode number 902 and Double Shot number 796. These two trades are the start of eras. Though the first one, the era of this one's actually over with because it was played by a different writer. Though this is the start of a 20-issue run plus one annual. This is Wonder Woman, Volume 6, Children of the Gods. Why do I say this is the start of an era? Because James Robinson takes over the book from the filler writer who did the last five issues of this particular run. This collects issues 31 to 37, written by James Robinson. This is the start of his era, and an era that would end after Healing was on the book about a good year, and then he left. I don't know why. There's not many articles released about why he left, but he just did. Artwork by Carlo Pagliarini, Sergio Davalia, Emilia Labacadio, and Steven Segovia, I think you pronounce it. Jenny Ferguson does the artwork. This book, this storyline, is something that here's the thing. It's a follow-up to Darkseid War. Yes, this storyline is a follow-up to that. Plus, it's something that apparently there was a rumor this was hinted at even as far back when Greg Rucka was in the book, that Wonder Woman has a twin brother. Yeah. A twin brother she knew nothing about. His name is Jason, and he is named after Jason of Jason the Argonauts. And the man who raised him was one of those Argonauts. Yeah, just by sheer coincidence. And he's got the same powers as Wonder Woman. Now, at this point, he has not met Steve Trevor yet. He does meet him a little bit later during Robert's, which I think that was a fantastic idea. Yeah, Wonder Woman's brother meeting Wonder Woman's boyfriend. Yeah, that's quite interesting. Yeah, this also features the return of Grell. And like I said, also, when it comes to this character, first time this character has been seen since Darkseid War. No, they do reference not only Darkseid War, they also reference Dark Knight's Metal, which is something because not many books reference that particular event. I know Justice League has frequent references to that particular event. I think there's some mild references to it in the pages of Detective Comics. This book is one of them. And I believe Teen Titans and Titans also references, well, I think maybe even Suicide Squad. I'm a little surprised Wonder Woman referenced it, but yeah, she's part of the event, so why not? And this also features the return of Darkseid. Well, the Darkseid baby, which has gotten bigger. How in the world is Dark... And of course, Darkseid gets to return Israel to full power. How? By killing off the Greek gods. As for how in the world that he came with the idea of somehow that killing the Greek gods will restore him to full power? I have no idea. First, he starts with basically Zeus's kids. I mean, first person you know where they killed, he kills Hercules. Now, Wonder Woman mentions in here that she's never met Hercules before. When in actuality, she has. In another book, she met him in the pages of Jeff Parker's Aquaman run. Yeah, it was back in Aquaman number two. Now, apparently either one, Wonder Woman forgot about this, or two, Robinson knew nothing about this at all, because when this storyline came out, when the whole thing came out, he was working for Marvel at that point, so he probably didn't know anything about Wonder Woman meeting Hercules before, and the fact that Wonder Woman has met Hercules many times over the years. I mean, I think, like, the first known official time she's met him was probably back in the 80s when George Perez wrote the book. And it was also in the flashback that apparently Hercules was an evil man and he raped Wonder Woman's mother. No, Hercules did not impregnate Wonder Woman's mother. That was the whole thing with Clay. And here, in this continuity, since Brian has earlier rebooted, since the whole universe rebooted back in 2011, she's the daughter of Zeus. As for why in the world they decided to change her classic origin story, as far as I know, I have not met Brian Azzarello, so I've never asked him that question. Of course, I've met Meredith Finch. She's probably by far one of two writers I know of who have worked on Wonder Woman that I've met. The other, of course, being Jerry Conway. Yeah, he did write Wonder Woman for a brief period of time back in the early 80s. Yep. But in the case of this particular story, I even see a fight in here that I never expect to see, even in any comic book. Darkseid versus Zeus. And Robert C. handles this fight pretty well. Despite the fact Zeus loses, this is a really damn good fight. It's been over the course of almost an entire issue. And you have Jason, who apparently decided to stab his own sister in the back. And then later on, he turns against the woman who actually he helped to turn against his own sister. Yep. And also, Steve Trevor is still, he's back with the Navy now. Yeah, this is the thing that bothers me during Ruckus Run. Why in the world did they have him switch branches in the military? Because he generally was always U.S. Army. He was like this for years, since probably back in the 40s, back in the 30s. As for why he decided to switch to Navy, as far as I know, they mentioned he wanted to be simpler. In actuality, I don't think even Robinson knows why he switched the branches for. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I think, was anything else I mentioned about this book? Not really, no. Though they do have a brief appearance by the Justice League in here. Though this is actually, believe it or not, the first time that I can think of the entire Justice League roster has appeared in a Wonder Woman comic since, off the top of my head, I think it was before Gail Simone wrote this book. Because Azrael had no appearance by the Justice League. Though in the case, but what about Mary the Finch's run? She had appearance by Cyborg and Aquaman, but that's it. No other members of the Justice League. This is by far the first and so far only time that the Justice League roster has popped up in the pages of Wonder Woman I can think of. They may have popped the Mary the Finch run, but I don't remember. It's been a while since I've read it. But this really gave this book a 9.5 out of 10. Yeah. This is by far Robinson's first book he did back at DC, and as far as I know, this is the only book he's done since he returned to DC, because he was abruptly removed from the book after doing 23 issues, actually more 20 issues, and he got replaced by the writer of Ms. Marvel, G. Willow Wilson, which she's leaving Ms. Marvel with the next issue. Yeah, despite the fact that she's already on, she came on the book with issue 51. And she's looking for a good, 10 issues now. It's really good, interesting little run. Yep. But I do think that Robinson was a fantastic choice to have write Wonder Woman. Because even though he's never really written Wonder Woman before that I can think of. But he knows DC Comics. Apparently he did know about Darkseid War. He did know about that. But apparently he knew nothing about Jeff Parker's Aquaman. Which is kind of weird. Despite the fact when Darkseid War came out, he was looking for Marvel Comics at that point. It's kind of the same thing with Jeff Parker's Aquaman. Working for Marvel. Yes, doing books like Scarlet Witch, Fantastic Four, Squadron Supreme. I mean, he did a boatload of books. At least DC knows how to treat him with a good amount of respect and actually have him on the book for more than 15 issues and not cancel the book for no reason. Yep. Alright, now moving on to the start of another era for a particular writer. We have the start of the run of Jason Aaron's run on Avengers. Yep, he does the writing for this with Ed McGuinness on the artwork. And I spoke to him about this. And yes, it is indeed true that the last time that Jason Aaron and Ed McGuinness worked on a book prior to doing this was indeed the quest for Nightcrawler arc for the Amazing X-Men run. Yeah, that was the last official time, and Ed McGuinness did confirm that with me. Yes, that was the last official time. Of course, that came back in 2013. So it'd been a good 5 years since these two worked together on a comic book. I gotta say, Ed McGuinness does a fantastic job drawing these characters. Mm-hmm. Now, the thing is, the one thing the book did not bother to explain, despite the fact this was released right after the events of No Surrender, apparently the Avengers disbanded again. As far as I know, there is, in the book, they don't explain why they disbanded. They just disband for some reason. It's never explained. So, the Avengers come back together, first with Captain America, Iron Man, Thor, the new Oscar reference, which I'm happy with them for the past couple years, like Tony being in a coma, Captain America being hydrated, and Thor losing his hammer. Though they don't mention the fact he also lost his arm as well, which is kind of weird. But I guess Jason Aaron is the one who actually, well, he's kind of the one who wrote that into continuity. You know, the whole thing of him losing his arm. Yeah, that was Jason Aaron. He did it himself. And plus, you got to thank Jason Aaron for the responsibility of with this current look that Thor has. Yep. And I got to say, when I first saw this lineup, I'm like, this is a quite interesting lineup. Aside from having simply Captain America, Iron Man, and Thor, because those three are probably necessary, and I'm sure that Marvel editorial probably told Jason Aaron, if you're gonna do Avengers, fine. You gotta have these three here. There's no ifs, buts about it. These have to be here because we say so. So I'm thinking, like, that's probably what happened. So he probably like, okay, but can I add more people besides these three? He's like, sure. So who does he add? Doctor Strange, Captain Marvel, the Black Panther, and the Robbie Reyes, oh yeah, they also had She-Hulk, and the Robbie Reyes Ghost Rider. Out of all these people, the Robbie Reyes Ghost Rider has never been part of the Avengers before, which I gotta say for Jason Aaron, yes, that's actually quite unique. That's actually a really good idea. Because Robbie Reyes has never been part of a team before, and plus, he's not been around for very long. No, he's only been around for a good... At the time this came out, he only been around for about 5 years. Because his only appearance he made to date prior to this was the only new Ghost Rider series, another Ghost Rider series done by the creator, and show up Marvel Legacy. And that's it. That's all that's been done with this character. I mean, I personally have no problem with the character at all. I love the fact they don't reference the his books at all. No, they mostly talk about his car and the fact that he can actually transform other things aside from his own car and give it his old hell look. Yeah. Now, in case of why that he added Doctor Strange, now why Jason Aaron added Doctor Strange's book, my theory, because Jason Aaron wrote, because he was the first regular writer who actually wrote Doctor Strange. And I'm sure Jason Aaron really enjoyed writing the character so much. I mean, he wrote for a good almost 2 years before he left the book, just prior to Secret Empire starting up. So, you're like, okay, I'll do this character. She-Hulk, I'm sure that's what he wanted to do, but there wasn't it. Now, a few people were saying that apparently Jason Aaron decided to go backwards on some of her character development. I do kind of agree with that. They make her kind of like how she was back in the 80s. Where she kind of talks like the regular Hulk. I'm glad in fact she's green again, because if you read her last title, she did for most of her run, she was actually gray. Yeah. And apparently it was very painful for her to turn into She-Hulk. Yeah. And I'm thinking, you know, like, okay, apparently she's got a lot bigger and bulkier, which that is quite something. I mean, yes, they're trying to do something new with her. And plus they have her start a relationship with Thor of all people. Which, I think that's a weird thing to do. Though, she is a creative Stan Lee, so it's perfectly acceptable. As for why they had to have Thor hook up with She-Hulk, as far as I know, there's no reason for this at all. I mean, it's not exactly a very despised relationship. I mean, it wasn't exactly forced. It was very heavily teased prior to the relationship happening. Instead of having this relationship completely out of nowhere, like in the case of Gorgon and Medusa. Yeah, that relationship lasted for like one issue. A relationship that was mentioned for like one issue, happened, they had sex, and then never mentioned again. At least in the case of this is actually a relationship I think Jason Aaron probably wanted to do, and he probably wanted to build it up. And apparently Doctor Strange, yeah, they also, of course, the storyline for this is that the Celestials, who apparently being killed off somehow by this thing called the Final Host, as for what this thing is, Jason Aaron does not clearly explain what the heck the Final Host is. And yeah, the story started off with apparently this Final Host killing off Celestials. Yeah, and also causing the whole rain of giant robots falling from the sky. And Captain Marvel had to basically avoid this, so they do reference some stuff that might be happening in her book, though at the time this was released, her book was technically not being published. Yes. Because we had the Life of Captain Marvel miniseries being published. Yes. Excuse me. And we also had the Eternals pop up in here. And apparently, all of them except for Icarus commit mass suicide. I'm like, what the heck is this, Jason Aaron? Why the heck would you have the Eternals? Characters are creations of Jack, late Jack the King Kirby, and you have them kill each other? Especially since one of whom happened to be an Avenger, Cersei, who also happened to be a one-time girlfriend of the Dan Wolpin Black Knight. Why he did this? No idea. He said, and the way it's explained, oh yeah, apparently everything you believe is all lies, so the Eternals commit mass suicide? Okay. And apparently Doctor Strange has never heard of the Eternals before, which is kind of weird. I would have thought he would have heard of them, especially since he's heard of the Celestials, but not the Eternals. I would have thought Tony Stark would have mentioned them to him at some point. But apparently, Jason Aaron, he probably didn't know, or just whatever. It's particularly very weird. So, when you read this, like, you scratch your head, like, okay, I thought they knew them, or like, okay. And half the time, Doctor Strange was written here, like, he didn't know what the heck was going on, or who these creatures are. Oh yeah, and Captain Marvel, despite the fact being the world's powerfulest superhero, even she points out she's regularly the bug duty. Which I think is quite funny. And she's working with Black Panther. Not a bad idea. Though, the one person did complain to Jason on Twitter, like, why isn't Spider-Man in this lineup? Because he wants to leave the eighth member as a rotating member of the roster. Yep. Also, during the course of the storyline, the robbery as Ghost Rider takes possession of a body of a dead Celestial. That's quite cool. That's awesome. Yeah, despite the fact that this storyline is really good, there's some leaps and bounds. Like, what? Really? Okay. But great storyline. Give this book a 9.5 out of 10. Really good. Despite my problems, some of my problems with the storyline, it's a really good storyline, and it's told really well over the course of 6 issues. Yep, collecting the first 6 issues of volume, I believe this is volume 7, and a story from the Free Comic Day issue for Avengers Last Kingdom. This is actually last year's Free Comic Day. Yeah, it was actually one of 2 Free Comic Day issues released last year. The other, of course, was the Spider-Man one. And yes, I am going to this year's Free Comic Day. I'll probably go to the same place I went last year, which was Uncanny Heroes. As for when in the world, like, what I'm going to get there, as far as I know, there has not been an announcement exactly what is going to come out on Free Comic Day or what the sales are going to be. Of course, that's only 3 months away, so I've got time to basically go about it until then. Mm-hmm. And one thing I appreciate, though, about this particular book is that Jason Aaron is setting up stuff for the future. As a matter of fact, he didn't have a recent issue of this thing where it didn't focus on the Avengers at all. It felt like, though, he was trying to set up another ongoing series called The Agents of Wakanda. And one of them happened to be, of all people, a former potential Thor love interest, Roz Solomon. Yeah, I would have thought these two hooked up because, well, it's hinted that Roz has a thing for him. She has a thing for him. But as far as I can tell, Jason Aaron never developed a relationship with her, which is kind of weird. Yeah. Who is a woman who is a great character, and I thought would make a great relationship with Thor, especially since, well, she's a S.H.I.E.L.D. agent, and she's a beautiful woman, and she thinks that Thor is hot. And at one point, Thor actually asked her out to dinner, and he's like, oh, nah, I'll have a coffee instead. Which I thought was so funny funny and cute at the same time. Mm-hmm. Yeah. If I meet Jason Aaron, I'm going to ask him, why in the world were you killing off characters who were created by Jack Kirby? Yeah. I'm going to ask him that. Like, why did he do this for? I mean, the only problem I had with this storyline was Death of the Eternals. That's the only thing I have a problem with. It. I mean, I didn't have a problem with the Dead Celestials because that actually was built upon the story. And plus, one thing I also was really cool, I forgot to mention this, Loki is in this storyline. Yes, because Loki is technically responsible for the creation of the Avengers. And it makes perfect sense for Jason Aaron to have Loki have the Avengers come back together. Great idea. Though apparently, the way at one point they had Captain Marvel and Iron Man arguing, like they always reference Civil War 2 in here, which is kind of odd. It's like, what are you going to do, beat me to a coma again? Yeah, there's a joke about that. And also, apparently, Doctor Strange has got a slightly... He's wearing the outfit he's currently wearing in his own solo book. And Cap, of course, is going back to his classic look. Mm-hmm. Also, in case you're wondering, do the Avengers get base operations in this particular run? Yes, they do. Except it's in the body of a dead Celestial. The Celestial that the Robert Reyes Ghost Rider took possession of and became Avengers Mountain. And the base operations is in, of all places, the North Pole. Yeah, I don't remember exactly what the reason for this, but it's quite interesting, though, they actually had something different. Because I do love seeing the Avengers headquarters, either the mansion or the tower. I didn't really care for them having the headquarters, of all things, a airport hangar during the all-in-all-different Avengers run. I did enjoy them having the headquarters of the Bax building. That was interesting, despite how brief of a tenure it was. Yeah, all because that... It had nothing to do with the fact of Civil War 2. Oh, no. It dealt with the fact that Sacred Empire got in the way, whatever the heck that Mark Waid had planned for them being headquartered there, because Raph, that... The main Team Avengers didn't have base operations, though they did decide to hang out the mansion. As for where the heck the mansion is, no idea, because last time I checked... The mansion is owned by the Human Torch, and you could have Fantastic Four headquartered the Avengers Mansion. There's nothing that says they can't do it because, well, the Human Torch is legally owned the place because, well, he bought the place with Reed Richards' money. Because the Bax building is owned by somebody else. Yep. So, that's really it for this particular review. Stay tuned for my review for my next comic corner, which I'm talking about two Batman trades. Yep. One is a mini-series, the other is the finale for a particular writer's run. Okay? But until I see next few, bye.